today I'm just going to emphasize how the E8 really algebra is deeply connected with the Klee for 16, the algebra in 16 dimensions. So I'll talk a little bit about Klee for algebras, since after all, Amrik is teaching you about Klee for algebras once a week, right? Once a week you have. And then I will show you how the E8 generators can be expressed as a subalgebra of the Klee for 16. Remember, the Klee for 16 algebra can be written as the tensor product of CL8 and CL8. And be very careful. Do not confuse the tensor product with the direct product. Okay? The tensor, this algebra has 2 to the 16 generators, which is not the same thing as 2 copies of CL8. Eh? You have to be very careful with that. Then I will discuss the SOA, the decomposition of SO16, because my perspective is to really look at everything from the 16-dimensional point of view. And then you look down to 8 dimensions, and then you can look down to your 4 and 3 dimensions. But my perspective is a 16-dimensional perspective, okay? And then you can realize that you can decompose the SO16 generators. You can break them up into SO8 pieces, okay? And then I will discuss a particular basis of the E8 generators. I will talk a little bit about the octonions and E8. The standard model fermions. I will talk a little bit about composite gauge fields. You know, how many of you have heard of the neutrino theory of light? Does it ring a bell? By de Broglie. He thought that the photon was composite, made of 2 neutrinos. Then I'll talk a little bit about the vast number of grand unified models. Okay, I already referred to you to the paper by the Japanese guy that had almost 1,900 pages. Okay, so let me proceed. Okay, so I guess Amrik already told you what a Klee for algebra is. For example, when you have a Klee for algebra in D dimensions, your basic generators are, if you are in D dimensions, there are D of them, and the Klee for algebra is defined in terms of the anti-commutator relations. It's not surprisingly, the Klee for algebra is connected with fermions, and when you deal with fermions, you deal with anti-commutation relations. When you deal with bosonic fields, you deal with commutators. So this is how you define the algebras. Okay, so this is this bracket notation is the anti-commutator. Braces. I mean, I call it it's anti-commutator. Anti-commutator is defined like this, by a sum. Not a minus sign. Okay, a commutator will have a negative sign. An anti-commutator will have a plus sign.
In the book, I saw brackets with a plus sign.
Yes, it's a plus sign because you have a plus here. If you have a minus sign, it's a minus sign. It's just a convention, you know.
Sure.
Yeah, but you know what we mean. This is anti-commutator. Okay, so the algebra is given by this, where now GAB is the background metric. And that metric can have any signature you want. Okay, this is the Klee for algebra on a tangent space, on a flat space, where the metric could have any signature. It could have all pluses, all minus, mixed signature. By one here, I mean the unit element of your Klee for algebra. Many people just omit this one there, but it should be there. It should to remind you that it's a unit element of the algebra. And of course, in general, I call this a space-time metric, but in reality, of course, when you have many different signatures, you should really think of it as a pseudo-Euclidean metric, where you could have, in D dimensions, you could have P and Q signature. You could have P plus signs and Q minus signs, okay? But you know what I mean. It could have any combinations of plus and minus you want. But this is the metric you put here in the right-hand side of the anti-commutator. Yeah. Yes, Fang, you were saying?
I was just wondering
that
D is a space-time metric.
No, D is a total space. In the case of Minkowski space, you choose 3 spatial dimensions and 1 temporal dimension. So you could have 3 plus 1. Or you can choose the opposite signature. You could choose 1, 3. So you have to be very careful because many authors define the signature with the opposite convention than physicists define it. The bottom line is that the signature could be anything you want. Okay? So Clifford algebras are defined in spaces of any signature. Any signature.
Why is that known as the signature?
Yeah?
The metric form get in sign? You had pluses for the first P and
then
minuses?
Yeah, I have P positive, and then here you have Q. If you count the number of negative signs, is Q. This is a choice. I choose to define it like this, the quadratic form. This is how I define it. There's no sign flip. This is my choice. Now, Lunesto may define it with the opposite way. He may define it this with minus signs and this guy with plus signs. It's just a convention.
Space and time has
opposite
signs. Is it space and time?
This is, I call it, quote unquote, this is my space-time. Think of a generalized space-time where you have many temporal directions and many spatial directions.
So you have Q temporal dimensions? Is that what you mean here?
Yes.
Because generally, time is one dimension.
Yes.
So you have to consider the I there. That's why they become that minus.
Yes. Now, okay, so roughly speaking, the gammas are just the square roots of plus or negative ones. You can think of it as the square roots of plus or negative one. By one here, I don't mean the number one, but it's really the unit element of your algebra that can be represented by a matrix with entries 1, 1, 1, 1. So think of the gammas as the square roots of plus minus the identity matrix. That's the simplest way you can visualize what a Clifford algebra is. Okay, you can think in simplest terms. Now, for example, in four dimensions, we have, remember, in four dimensions, a Clifford algebra in four dimensions has 2 to the power of 4, has 16 generators. So if your dimension of the algebra is 16, you can think of 16 as being broken in terms of 4 by 4 matrices, because 4 times 4 is 16. So the number of independent matrices will be 16. It has to match the dimension of your space. So you can think of 4 by 4 matrices. And now you can introduce indices. Remember, alpha, beta. Now these indices is what physicists call spinorial indices. So the entries of these matrices, the rows and columns, can be thought as spinorial, as spinners. Okay.
So you're writing this in
generators. And now,
which are matrices.
Yeah.
You also showed us in the very first lecture that you could have differential operators instead of the matrices.
Yes. Yeah.
If you use the differential operators, then if you plug that in here, would you get a Poisson bracket?
No. You have to use anticommutator. Anticommutator differential operators. Remember, you can write. No. Poisson bracket is something else. You're dealing with momentum space. You're dealing with the symplectic space. You need to tell me what the symplectic form is. It's different. Yeah. So now let's suppose I want to represent these algebra generators. I want to represent them in terms of matrices. I can go ahead and represent them in terms of matrices. So now we can take the anticommutator of two matrices. I take this product in this order. I take the product in the reverse order, and I add them up, like adding matrices. And this is what you get. You get the product of the two matrices. Here I reverse the order of my matrices. And then I do a matrix multiplication. You know, you take rows with columns, and this is what you get. So on the right-hand side, you'll get the unit matrix. And then, of course, here you have the entrance of your unit matrix, which is a Kronecker delta, where now alpha and beta range from 1, 2, 3, 4. So you have 4 rows and 4 columns. But so these alphas and betas are really what spinorial indices. Because the spinor in Clifford algebra, rigorously speaking, a spinor is nothing but what they call a left or right ideal element of an algebra. So a spinor really is a matrix. You can think of here as a 4 by 4 matrices, where you have one column made of the entries of your spinner, and everything else zero. Or you can think of it as a row of entries, which is a non-zero, and the rest are all zero. So spinners, you know, usually you're represented by a column or a row. You know what the ideal of an algebra is? An ideal element is when you have any element of your algebra, you multiply it by an ideal, you get an element of your ideal. So, for example, a spinor, you know, people write spinors with the components alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, let's see, in four dimensions, you know. In reality, you can think of it as the entries of a matrix, of a 4x4 matrix, and where everything else is zero, okay? Also, you can think of the transpose of the column matrix is a row matrix. So you can think of as this, the transpose spinner as the entries of a matrix involving only rows. So you can think of the transpose spinner as, for example, a row where everything has the entries and everything else zero. And why is that? Because now if you can think of this of a matrix, if you have a matrix, if you multiply by an element of the ideal, you will get an element of the ideal. Okay? And vice versa, if you reverse the order of multiplication, if you have an element of your ideal, if you multiply it on the left with the matrix, you have an element of the ideal. So you can see that when you play with these matrices, like this, where you have one column of entries which are not zero and everything else is zero, and vice versa, when you have a row of entries which are not zero and the other is zero, so you can see that when you multiply the matrices by the right or the left, you're going to have an element that will have zeros everywhere but except on the row, or zeros everywhere except on the column. So this is what you call an ideal of your algebra. So from the point of view, a spinor is really a left or right ideal element of your Clifford algebra.
So here you mean not subset, but belongs to parenthesis I.
Yeah, belongs. Well, because I'm dealing, okay, so you want me to use the symbol this?
That within the and I within the parenthesis on the right hand side.
Okay.
This is what you exactly
mean. Yes. An element, yes.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I mean, as long as the important thing is that you understand what I'm saying, yeah.
The ideal is close under the matrix.
Yes, the ideal is close under the matrix on the left. Yeah. Like I said, yes. So you have rows and columns, okay?
Yeah.
Well, spinors are tricky. Eh? Spinors are more subtle than this, you know. Okay, so let me. Can I proceed? Yeah. Okay, so the dimension of a Clifford algebra in this space-time dimension. But think of it as a space with any signature you want is 2 to the d. For example, in four dimensions, a Clifford algebra has 16 generators. Or you can think of them as 16 matrices. And each matrix is comprised of 4 rows and 4 columns. So the 2 to the 16 matrices are obtained as follows. You have the unit element, you can represent it by the diagonal matrix. By a diagonal, I mean the major diagonal, okay? The 4 vectors, quote unquote, are represented by 4 matrices, where gamma A is gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, gamma 4. The 6 vectors are represented by this anti-symmetric combination. This is what I call, remember, I call the wedge product of gamma A wedge gamma B. So this is the anti-symmetric combination. The trivectors are represented by this anti-symmetrization. You know, you take the products, the triple product, and you anti-symmetrize. A quadrivector is represented by the matrix. And because I'm working with four dimensions, I cannot anti-symmetrize any further because I will get zero eventually. And remember, in four dimensions you have a natural object which is anti-symmetrizes everything, which is the epsilon symbol, you know, the epsilon symbol, which is plus or negative one depending if you have an even or odd permutation. And this is what people call the gamma 5, because when you're working in four dimensions, when you anti-symmetrize everything, you get a matrix which they call a gamma 5, which has to do with the chirality matrix. For example, if you're working in 1 million dimension, when you anti-symmetrize a product of 1 million matrices, that anti-symmetrization will be called the 1 million plus one. It's just for example, when you're working in, I don't know, what example could I give you? Let's count the number of matrices. Okay, here I have one matrix because it's the unit matrix. The four vectors will correspond to four matrices, so I have four of them. The six divectors will correspond to six matrices. The four trivectors are four matrices, and then the quadrivector is like that. So in the language, you could think of the unit matrix as your scalar. You can think of your vectors as your vector. You could think of your bivectors as being self-dual, in a way. You could think of your trivectors as a dual of a vector, because a trivector has three indices. In order to complete the dimension of your space, you need an extra index. So a vector will be like the Hodge dual of a trivector. And a quadrivector here is like a Hodge dual of in reality it's a pseudo-scalar, you know. Gamma subscript 5. It's a label I call. I can call gamma anti-symmetrization. Let's suppose I write here 1, A is 1, B is 2, C is 3, D is 4. So in the Lunesto notation, the way Lunesto defines it, using notation, Lunesto's notation, he doesn't use the word gamma, he uses the word E. Okay, so in reality, take in four dimension, this is what I mean.
Gamma sub A,
yeah.
A takes on values 1 to 4.
Yes.
So gamma 5 is not a generator?
Gamma 5 is one of the elements of your algebra, because it's due to this, the product of four gammas, the anti-symmetrization of the four gammas is your gamma 5. It's what I call gamma 5. Gamma 5 is this guy over here, is the dual of the unit element of your algebra. This will be your scalar, and this will be your pseudo-scalar.
So gamma 5 is the scale variation of the quadrivector.
Yes.
Gamma A, B, C, D.
Yes.
Within any permutation of A,
yes,
B, C, D.
Yes, yes, yes.
Which is related to gamma 5.
Yeah.
So is it always the binomial of expansion coefficients, the 1, 4, 6, 4, 1?
Yes.
As you go up, does it make Pascal's triangle?
Yes, exactly. And this is why when you count all your elements, you get 2 to the power of D. Okay. In practice, one omits the matrix indices of the gamma matrices, and one does not include the anti-symmetrization symbol. For example, you call a p vector here when you have p indices here. So by this gamma sub a1, a2, ap, this really means the wedged product of gamma a1. Which product of gamma A2, blah, 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 which product of gamma P. Okay, and a Q vector, again, you have Q indices here. So, you know, it means the anti-symmetrization of the product of gammas. Okay? So, yeah, I'll let Fang, because Fang is... No, go ahead. It's important, after all, this is why we're here. You mind if I take my shoes off? Because, yeah. Yes. But Andrew, you use the Lunesto notation, you use the E's.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, physicists, we use the gammas, you know, yeah. Okay, now by a Clifford geometric product is nice when you compose a p vector with a q vector. This is what we were talking the other day when you wrote in your paper s times the trivector. Yeah, because I didn't see the s. So you see when you have a p, remember when you have the multiplication rule of angular momentum, when you compose angular momentum, when you have angular momentum 3, for example, and you want to add to angular momentum 1. Remember what you did? You took 3 plus 1 was 4, and 3 minus 1 was 2. So here's very similar. When you compose a p vector with a q vector, you're going to have a superposition of different p vectors. So you're going to have p plus q will give you a p plus q vector, and then you could subtract in 2. Because you are contracting indices, and eventually you end up with a grade of p minus q. So you start with p plus q, which is the maximum combination you could have. And as you keep contracting indices, you end up with a p minus q. And I write the absolute symbol because sometimes q could be greater than p. Here, an example, you'll understand here. Let's suppose I want to compose gamma A with gamma B. So you know that the product of two matrices can be written as the sum of an anticommutator with a commutator. So here, let me write it here. Yes, and then the index explanation will be clear. Yeah. I guess Lunesto uses the word blade. Blade, right?
He also uses grade.
Grade, okay, blade. Okay, let's use grade, okay? For example. Let's have here, come on, two pants. Grade one, okay? Let's have here grade one, okay? So when you have a one with a 1, then what you do is you take 1 plus 1 is 2, and 1 minus 1 is 0. Okay? So you're going to have, the composition will have an object of grade 2 and grade 0. And how does this manifest? Remember when you multiply a matrix, you can write the product as, you can write this product as gamma AB plus gamma BA, okay, I'll introduce the two later, plus gamma AB minus gamma BA, remember, and then I can divide by 2, right, and I can divide by 2. So what I have done is I have the product of two matrices, I have written them as a combination of an anticommutator with a commutator. You are familiar with that, right? So this is what I have in the first term. Here is the anticommutator, which is, I have here the first term. And over here I have the commutator, which is what I have here. Okay? So I end up, this is the definition of a Clifford algebra. Of course, I put the 2 on the left-hand side. But the anticommutator, you know, remember, it's twice GAB. So you bring the 2. This term here is given to this. It's equal to this by definition of your Clifford algebra. Because the anticommutator is twice GAB unit element. So when you divide by 2, you get rid of the 2 and you get this. Okay? So this unit element is your scalar, the 0 grade. The 0 grade is the 0 grade, this is your 0 grade, and this object here, the commutator, is the 2 grade, it's a bivector. Okay? Yeah, let Amrik think. Yeah. So here I have, when I use this rule, 1 plus 1 is 2, it will give me the grade 2, and when I have 1 minus 1 is 0, it will give me the grade 0, which this will give me something proportional to the unit matrix. Okay, so I'll let you digest this. So when you have a one-grade object and you compose it with a one-grade object, what you will get is an object of grade 2 and an object of grade 0. It's like angular momentum. Remember when you have when you add two particles whose angular momentum is 1, what is the possible combination? 1 plus 1 is 2, and 1 minus 1 is 0. Remember in quantum mechanics?
I could be wrong. I'm probably wrong here, for sure, right? But let's go through it anyway. So you said angular momentum. Angular momentum has a dimension. You get one where you have grade 2, so you're raised to the power 2, and the other which is grade 0.
Yes.
Isn't there a conflict of dimensionality?
No, grade. I'm talking about grade. Grade.
So grade doesn't correspond to the dimension?
No. You have to be very careful. The dimensions is something else.
So the dimensions do not come in the picture of generators, is it? When you write L sub x, that is dimensionless?
In physical dimensions?
Yes.
No, but here these generators, you call them dimensionless.
So these are all dimensionless?
Physically dimensionless.
So
yeah, there's an H bar. What happens is that physicists always like to equate H bar to 1. You see, they set H bar to 1. But in reality, when you write the commutation relations of angular momentum, remember, you have, okay, I'm going to use Hermitian generators. You write H bar, remember?
Yes.
Because, of course, this has angular momentum dimension. This is an H bar. So H bar is square, it matches the dimension of these guys, because now H times H has the same dimensions on the left-hand side with the right-hand side.
So let's do the same here.
But here I'm working with dimensionless quantities.
So here you're working with dimensionless, yeah. There the commutator relation was dimensionless.
Yeah, well, it's because if we want to use angular momentum. But in reality, remember, the angular momentum L sub x, you define it as H bar times your generator. Your generator, which letter do you want to use? Let's use like this. Okay, let's use calligraphy.
Okay.
Yes, so calligraphy. So now it's H bar L x. Okay.
So implicitly you have normalized it.
Yes.
So
Yes. Remember, the Clifford algebra generators are dimensionless. You know, they deal with mathematics. The physicists are the ones who introduce physical dimensions later. But when you talk of an algebra, you talk always, of course, dimensionless objects, you know. And physicists, of course, they equate everything to 1. H bar is equal to 1, C equals to 1. Newtonian constant equal to 1, Boltzmann constant equal to 1, everything is equal to 1. And then at the end, they like to simplify. Okay.
The gamma AB is the grade 2, and the GAB comes 1. Is that also grade 2?
No, this is grade 0.
0 grade?
Yes, the unit matrix. The unit is your unit element of your algebra.
So GAB?
No, GAB is the space-time metric. It's not an element of your algebra. It's like a structure or constant. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Because this is dimensionless, that you can have different grades.
Yes.
In the same
exactly.
Addition.
That's right. Because
even if it's different grade, but this is the same dimension, which is dimensionless.
Physically, then.
Otherwise, yes, it will be.
No. Otherwise, you have to introduce. Otherwise, if you want to match physical units, this is where you have to introduce the Planck scale. Remember, I was telling you about the extended relativity in Clifford spaces. You have to introduce the Planck scale in order to match physical dimensions.
So every time you want to do physics with this kind of algebra, you have to normalize it and then do the...
Yeah. Okay. Now, let me give some examples of commutators and anti-commutators. Okay? So this is the typical example. This is given by the commutator. So this object, you call it A sub B because it's a grade 2 object. And of course, it's anti-symmetric, because if you reverse the order of your generator, you change sign. Yeah, like the America's writing. Let me.
Carlos.
Yeah.
So gamma AB.
Yeah.
Is that gamma? How does that relate to gamma A wedge gamma B?
It's the same thing.
It's the same thing.
Yes. And of course, it's anti-symmetric, and if I reverse the order, I will flip the signs, okay? And now let's look at the second and third line. Yeah, I'll let Amrik write after all, because he's teaching the course on Clifford algebra.
So, Carlos, can you go back to one page?
Yes, of course. Yes. So you want me to go here? Yeah, a p vector, the symbol p, it means that I have p indices below the gamma.
Okay.
And the symbol q means I have q indices below the gamma.
Okay, so you multiply them together.
In the wedge product, yes. Yeah, I multiply them by anti-symmetrization. This is what you call the wedge product. Yeah. Yes, this in that case will be the wedge product of gamma A. Wedge product of gamma B can be represented in this notation.
So the last equation you have gamma A, gamma B, right?
This one?
No, but
here I don't have a wedge product. I have a geometric product. Don't confuse.
I'm talking about the first equation. Oh, yeah, that one. So that's not the wedge product.
No.
That's a geometric
product. The geometric product, yeah.
And it equals to
yes. You have the
Clifford product.
Yes, this is the Clifford product.
So all the way to the difference of
the Yes.
But it's still not clear because here you have a series of options. Here you just gave us p plus q and p minus q. Right?
In this case, because you only have a 1 and a 1. But in general, if I have a million minus 1, you could have many possibilities in between.
So,
I will show you how the contraction works. Okay, can I go to the, Okay, so here I have this. Now let's suppose I want to take the commutator of a vector with a two vector, okay? So when you do the algebra, you can deduce. This all can be deduced from first steps. You get this, okay? And when you take an anticommutator, you get this. Again, by the same principle. Let me look at this second line and let me just write it on the blackboard, okay? To show you what I did here. Yeah. I have the black pen here. Good. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to look at this commutator and I look at this anti-commutator. So, notice this is very interesting. Here, so let's look at the composition of a two vector with a one vector. Okay, so I have a two vector or a bivector and I want to compose it with a one vector. This is the Clifford geometric product. Or do you want to use letter B, C? Okay, let's, after all, yeah, you know, to be consistent with what I write on the screen. Yeah, otherwise, yeah, it'll be more confusing. Let's write B, C, and I'll write A over here. Okay, so this is grade 2. This is an object that has grade 2. This is an object that has grade 1. Okay, so when I combine 2 plus 1, I get 3, okay? And when I subtract 2 minus 1, I get 1, okay? And then the difference between 3 and 1 is a step of 2, okay? You'll see in a minute why is that. So what am I going to get? I'm going to get, okay, so remember what I said, that when you multiply two matrices, you can write them as a sum of your commutator plus anti-commutator. Okay, so you're going to have 1/2. You want me to use the anti-commutator first or the commutator first? Let's use the commutator first. And then over here, I'm going to use the anti-commutator, okay? B, C, okay? So, because we agree that the composition rule has to give me something which is a trivector and something which is a vector, what I have on the right-hand side has to be a linear combination of a trivector with a vector. Okay, and this is what we have here. When I take the commutator, I have a linear combination of a vector. Gamma C and gamma B are vectors. The GAB and the GACs are, think of them as a structure constant. Now, when I look at the anti-commutator of a vector with a bivector, I get a trivector, which is what we should have over here. You see, I have 2 plus 1 was 3, so I need to have a trivector, and I need to have a vector. So this is what I have here. I end up with a vector, and then I end up here with a trivector. Okay? No, because I'll give you the composition rule to any grade, any dimension. Believe me, it gets more complicated. Okay, let's look at this is where your rotors, your bivectors come from. Does this algebra ring a bell? Doesn't this look like?
Yes.
Like, what does it look like?
The Lorentz.
It looks like the Lorentz. It's just rotations are like bivectors. You can think of bivectors because, after all, this means a rotation in the plane represented by AB. And this is a rotation in the plane represented by CD. By CD, I mean axis number C. D means axis number D. You know, it's like a plane. Okay, bivectors is like a plane. Okay, so here, what you get here. So I'm going to write here, which letters I use? AB, okay, AB and CD, okay. Let me just erase. I'm going to take the product of matrices. Suppose I have the product of two bivectors, the Clifford products. So now I have a bivector on both sides. So now when I combine them, I get 2 plus 2 is what? 4, right? 2 plus 2 is 4. 2 minus 2 is 0. Okay? And in between, in steps of 2, I go from 0 to 4. In steps of 2, there is a 2 in between. It's like a ladder, you know, you go down the ladder or up the ladder in steps of 2. The reason you go up the ladder in steps of 2 is because you are contracting indices. You're going to contract indices. For example, here, you see this A here? When you contract with a C, you get AC, you know. And then you are left with the other pairing, BD. Okay. For example, when you take A and you contract with D, you get AD, and you are left with the remaining, okay? Now, let's suppose I wanted to ask you a question. For example, how do you know which sign to choose, plus, minus? It's very simple. The way you know which sign to choose, whether it's a plus or a minus, is very simple. What you do is you look at the permutation of these indices, A, C, B, D, and you compare that permutation with the way these indices appear on your left-hand side. Okay, so on your left-hand side, you see that A, B, C, D are ordered. In the right-hand side, they are not ordered. So you look at the order of the indices, and because A, C, B, D is an odd permutation, with respect to the indices in the left-hand side, you have a minus sign. Here, ADBC is an even permutation with respect to the indices on the left-hand side. You choose a plus sign. Okay, so this is like the thumb rule to figure out which index to which sign to choose.
So the anti-commutator would be a linear combination of grade 4 and grade 0 in this case.
In this case, okay, so let's insert here the what I wrote here. A, B, C, D. A, B, C, D. Okay, so this commutator of bivectors only gives me bivectors as I showed you, right? Because this is what I wrote on the last line. So therefore, if I want to, so the check mark, I have the bivector here. So I'm left with the zero grade and the four quadrivector. So this anti-commutator has to give me something with grade zero. So you're going to have your delta of Kronecker anyway. Something like that. And then you're going to have something of grade 2, a grade 0 and a grade 4, and then something which is fully antisymmetric. Okay, so you're going to have something that looks like this, grade 4 and grade 0. Okay, a combination of grade 0 and grade 4. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I just wonder how do you calculate the anti-commutator result?
The anti-commutator, well, the anti-commutator result, this is also an art form, but the anti-commutator has to give you a combination of 0 and 4, okay?
So,
by taking contractions, okay? So let's write the A, B, C, D in this form. Let's write the A, B downstairs and the C, D upstairs. Okay, that's probably more intuitively. So what you do, when you take the Clifford geometric product, okay, the Clifford geometric product, you're going to have something. What's the easiest thing you can do? The easiest thing you can do is just attach the indices to, yeah, I'm sorry, he's writing here.
No, I'm listening.
Yeah, you attach all the indices to your gamma, because 2 plus 2 is 4, so you have to have something that has grade 4, right? Then what you do is you perform a contraction of indices. So let's suppose that you contract this index A with this index C. When you contract them, you use the metric to contract indices, so you're only left with a delta Kronecker AC. And you are left with an index B and an index D. So you're left with BD, right? And then you go ahead and perform a contraction of the two indices, two upstairs and two downstairs. And then you end up with the Kronecker delta. I'll show you in a minute what is the Kronecker delta with more indices, okay? So you contract, and you cannot go any further, okay? So the commutator, because this is a bivector, is going to give you this guy over here. This is the commutator will give you this, and the anti-commutator will give you this pair, this other two.
Carlos, yeah. Can I write something?
Yes. Yes.
Can I write something?
Please.
Because Paul asked the question.
Yeah.
So he's writing for four dimensions. Now
yes.
Think of what we did in two or three dimensions.
Yes.
So when I was defining in the lectures how to find E12, remember I said this can be written as half of E1 dot E2 plus half E1 by vector E2, if you look at the notes.
Yes.
So this was the anti-commutator, and this was the commutator.
The other way around. The other way
around. The other way around.
Yes, the other way around.
And you could go back to the notes and see how we computed each of this.
Mm-hmm.
So in essence, you computed the anti-commutator and the commutator.
Yes. That's,
I think that's understandable. That's easy to understand. Easy to see here.
Yeah.
Like if you given some anti-commutator of like so many dimensions, I don't know how to get a result. That's
Yeah. No, but I'm going to give you the rules. I'm going to give you the rules. Okay. Dugan is coming back. Dugan is coming back. Yeah. Oh, okay. So let's summarize. So when I take when I perform this Klee Irwin product, I'm going to have grade 4, grade 2, grade 0, and I show you that the reason you get grade 4, grade 2, and grade 0, you jump in steps of 2, is because I'm contracting indices, a lower index with an upper indices, and of course when I contract indices, I must contract them in a pairwise function, in pairs, okay? So here, when I contract this index with this index, I get the Kronecker symbol. And when I contract all of them, okay, then I get this Kronecker symbol. I'm going to show you in a minute what everything is. Let me proceed and you'll see. Because I just don't remember when I got this formula. Because I think I got it from a book. No, this is actually... I'm sorry, I'll show you what I got.
Is it true that Amrita said that anti-commutative generators are the dot pattern?
Not always. Not always. In three dimensions, it makes sense. The anti-commutator will have many, many, many terms, and one of them will happen to be the dot product. Yes, and then you go, and then you move up the ladder, yes, and then you move up. Okay, so in fact, you're right. So the D-dimensional Lorentz algebra can be written in this form, where now the generators of your Lorentz generators can be written in bivector form, and they're given by this. So this algebra is isomorphic to the Lorentz algebra. And your Lorentz generators, remember, AB, because you have boost and you have rotations. So this basically is telling you like a rotation along the A and B direction, okay? Now, this is what Fang was wanting to know. How do you know which is which here? Okay. So now, let's suppose I have a P vector here, and I have a Q vector here. I have P indices below and Q indices above. So the commutator, by induction, how do you say, this is another word, induction? Deduction, induction. When you go to lower dimensions, like Amrick's text, and you move your way up,
induction,
then you can deduce this formula. Okay, so here, notice that, let's suppose that you take P and Q such that the product is odd. Let me give you an example. Let me give you the commutator. Let's suppose that we want to play with the Klee Irwin algebra in six dimensions. In six dimensions, so you have more and more degrees of freedom. So let's suppose you are working in six dimensions and I want to compute the commutator of a trivector with a trivector. Okay, and remember, I'm in six dimensions, so I can have A, B, C, and then I have D, E, F, okay? So I look at the grade of one of the generators, and I look at the grade of the other generator. So here, you see that I have grade 3 here, and I have grade 3 here, okay? So 3 times 3 is 9. And 9 is an odd number. So what I will get this. I will get the first term will be given by the compound of all the indices. Okay, so I'm going to get, in our case here, I'm going to get a 6 dash vector. I'm going to have a gamma. Well, the coefficients, don't worry at the moment for the coefficients, B, C, D, E, F. Okay, I'm going to have an object whose grade is 6. Okay, because remember, when you have a 3 with a 3, when you combine them, how many possibilities can you have? 3 plus 3 will be 6. 3 minus 3 is 0. So you have grade 0, grade 2, grade 4, and grade 6.
Obviously, I can check, but
Are all those terms in the same order?
Yes, you have to add all this until you saturate all the indices.
No, are they on the same order, the coefficients? Are they on the same order?
No, the coefficients, you have these factorials.
Yeah, so they will be different orders. Can you just drop some?
No. You have to keep those coefficients because those numbers are crucial. Those coefficients have to be there because then when you check the Jacobi identities, the Jacobi identities will not be satisfied. Remember, you always, if this is an algebra, you have to check the Jacobi identities. So those coefficients are crucial, because if you tweak with the coefficients, the Jacobi identity will not be satisfied. Yeah, you have to be extremely careful with those coefficients. They're essential. Now, these combinatories, do not worry about these combinatories. I mean, you see the way I got this. This formula from the book by John Schwartz and the German sisters, Melanie Becker, when they wrote a book on string theory and M theory about 5 years ago, Cambridge University Press. But they copy from someone else. But they don't give the references. They just give they write like 5-6 pages of formulas, but they don't give the proof. They just write it down anyway. But just believe me, this works out. So notice, of course, that the first element in this case has the maximum grade when the product of P and Q is odd. Then what happens to the next term? So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to contract the pair of indices, N1 with N2, with M1 and M2. So when that's why you have this Kronecker delta here. And the reason you pair in this fashion is because, remember, this Clifford geometric product follows a pattern of steps of 2. But when you take the commutator or the anti-commutator, the steps are in 4 steps. Okay, you'll understand in a minute why. So the geometric product goes in steps of 2, but the commutators and anti-commutators follow steps of 4. And the reason is because the commutators will give you half of the objects and the anti-commutator will give you the other half of the generators. So they have to divide it split in equal fashion. Okay? So if the product, in other words, remember I said that the product of 2 matrices is given by the sum of the commutator plus anti-commutator. So if the product goes in a stepwise fashion, then, in order to balance out the commutators with the anti-commutators, they have to jump in steps of 4. And why? Because here you have it. Here I have a pair of indices upstairs, N1, N2. I'm going to contract with a pair of indices downstairs. So I'm going to generate this delta symbol here. Now, what I mean here by this...
there's a gamma inside the delta?
Yeah. What this means is, according to Raymond's notations, what I'm doing here, I have a delta multiplying a gamma, and what this means upstairs, the anti-symmetrization symbol of all indices. So what I mean by this bracket here, which symbol do you want to use for this? It's not a bracket. What symbol do you use for this letter? It's like, well, this is the anti-symmetrization symbol. So here I have N1, N2, here I have N3, NQ. So what you do here, you anti-symmetrize all these indices, N1, N2, N3, NQ. I anti-symmetrize everything. Yeah, this is just a notation.
This is a notation.
So here what I mean, okay, the first one you understand. Let's look at the second one. The second one I have to contract. I'm going to contract a DE with an AB, and then I'm left with a gamma F and C, okay? Now what I'm going to do, Raymond, what I'm going to do over here, fine. You see these indices DE and F, AB and C? So what you do now is I'm going to anti-symmetrize indices. I'm going to take DE and F, and I'm going to look at all permutations of indices that I can have upstairs. And then I'm going to anti-symmetrize, again, look at the permutations of all the indices I can going to have downstairs. Okay? So for example, let's suppose I permute D with E here. I leave everything intact. I leave the AB intact. I leave the C intact, the F intact. And I permute the D with the E. So I'm going to have ED here. And then I'm going to have, for example, I'm going to leave.
Do you actually mean on the top with the stuff in parentheses?
Yes, that's what I mean by antisymmetrization of all the upper indices. And this symbol below means antisymmetrization of all lower indices. Okay, that's what I mean by that. Why do I need to have that? It's very simple, because if you look at this structure here, this structure is antisymmetric with respect to all the upper indices, N1, N2, all the way through Q. So here I have to have something that also preserves that antisymmetrization structure of indices. Okay? Yeah. And below the same. It's just, so you antisymmetrize the upper indices.
So
yeah.
That top guy means equal to whatever you have written,
yeah,
plus,
yeah,
delta DEAB gamma CF, is it? Is that a plus? Or
well, no, in that case, well, you have to check the sign, because remember, when I reverse the signs, remember this delta EDAB is going to be opposite in sign as D. I'm going to show you what the Kronecker delta symbol is. If you reverse the order, you're going to flip the signs, okay? But I'm going to show you what this is. I'm going to show you in a second what this delta of Kronecker is.
So you have all the permutations, but you only permute D and E, A and B, right?
Here you have to take all the permutations of M1, M2, and M3, and MP. Because No. You have to take, because remember, here the M1, M2 are all part of P,
okay,
of P indices. Here I have M1, M2 belong to all this family of indices.
So there you would have a permutation of D, E, and F then?
Yes, you could look at all permutations.
And would you add all the permutations?
And you have to combine all those terms together. Some of them will, some terms will appear with a plus sign, minus. Okay, so
you are summing them regardless of the sign. You are collecting all.
Oh yes, collecting all of them. Yes.
So that delta there represents a lot more terms than what's actually.
Oh yes, it's just a condensed notation. Yes, but I'm going to show you what it is. Okay, and then the next term. Yeah, all the possible combinations.
Yes.
Yeah, and why? It's because on the left hand side I had a p vector here, and I had a q vector here. So I have to respect the indice structure. So I have to respect the antisymmetrization of indices. Because remember, this P vector was the wedge product of gamma 1, gamma M1, gamma M2. So if I have an antisymmetrization structure on the left-hand side, I have to respect it. I have to make sure that I keep it on the right-hand side. Okay? Now let's look at the next term. Remember, here I contracted N1 with N2. I'm sorry, N1, N2 with M1, M2. Now, in the next step, I'm going to contract four indices upstairs with four indices downstairs.
So you are contracting, then you have to keep the N1, N2 together, right?
You have to contract it. I have to contract and permute. I have to contract and permute. Okay? Remember, this commutator is going to give me by a linear combination of all my generators. These are like the structure constants. Think of it as the structure constants.
I understand that.
Okay, now, you know what this symbol means? What I mean by a bracket between,
yeah.
You know what it means?
Antisymmetric.
All of the indices that I have within the bracket.
Yes.
Okay, again, and you understand what it means below, right?
Yes.
Okay, so you know what this operation means, right?
Sure.
Yeah. Well, you have to. That's why you have to do exercises. Yeah. That's why you have to do exercises. Yeah. For example, the 3 factorial is 6, so you can actually permute 3 elements. Now, 4 factorial is 24. That's a little bit more hard to write all the 24, right? But try with 3 entries. You can permute 3 entries here, because 3 factorial is 6. So you can write all the permutations with 3 entries. So this is something you can write down in a piece of paper. It's not so hard. after all, it's only six of them.
So would I permute first and then antisymmetrize?
No, you have to permute, and then you will have a plus sign if the permutation is even, and you'll have a negative sign if the permutation is odd.
This is what I mean by an antisymmetrization process.
When you antisymmetrize indices, you write down all the permutations. Forget about the signs.
So, but you will have six permutations at the top,
yeah.
Six at the bottom, so the combination is 36.
That's right. Yes.
Why you don't want to write it?
I don't want to write them because you have six on top, six on the bottom, six times six. You're going to have 36 combinations. Yeah.
I understand that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That two terms.
Go ahead. Yes. Yeah.
So this will give you 36 terms with plus and minus, right?
Yes.
Times six, as he said.
Yes.
How is that different from that?
Oh, that's very different because this object here is a four vector. And here I have a two vector here.
Wouldn't that also but of different structures?
No, because remember you will have a four. Yeah, you will have a four here. In that case, you wrote here two upstairs, two below.
Yeah.
So then in that case, you will have three here. You have six. And then you subtract them, and it will appear in the anti-commutator. It will appear. Let me see. This is the total is six. Six minus two is four. It will appear here. It will appear here. Two upstairs and two below. It will appear in the anti-commutator. It will appear here.
Why is it in
even?
Yes.
Three. No. Okay. It will appear here. It will appear because this is the next slide.
Oh, okay.
It will appear in the next slide, yeah. Okay, let me go to the prior slide.
Is that the PQ equal to that? Is that meant to be the products PQ or the sum?
No, the products being the products, yeah. Three here, three times three is nine. Uh-huh. The product is odd, so I have to use this formula. Okay?
There isn't any difference.
No, here it happens when PQ is even. When the product of P and Q is even,
uh-huh.
It happens that the anti-commutator, when the product of P and Q is even, happens to be equal to the commutator when the product is odd.
Yeah.
Okay, so they are the same. Mm. Okay. The expressions on the right-hand sides are the same.
So you're saying that will also have 36 terms, but that's a
Because
gamma is of rank 2.
Yeah,
right?
and this will be 4.
Rank 4.
Yes.
That means this is not the equation 4.4, that's not complete. We have to add another type of term.
Yes, you have to add until you saturate all indices, until you don't have any indices at your disposal. Okay. So now, so here in The two formulas are the same in the right-hand side, but the left-hand side is different because in one case I have a commutator, and in the other case I have an anti-commutator. And why? Because when P and Q is odd, you get this, and when P and Q is even, you get this. Okay?
Yes.
So let's look at the other possibilities. Now the other case is when the product, the P and Q is even, the commutator is that. When P and Q is odd, the anti-commutator is that. And of course, the expressions in the right-hand side are the same. But remember, here I have a commutator because the product of P and Q, P times Q is even. Here I have an anti-commutator and the product is odd. Okay? Okay, anyway, you have these slides in your...
So PQ even will have an anti-commutator and a commutator relationship with different structures.
Yes.
How do you calculate the Kronecker delta?
Okay, so then I'm going to tell you what it is. Yes. Okay. Okay. So I'm going to explain you to you. I want to explain to you what this symbol means. Yes, fine.
You
were saying.
Yeah. No, you can't have the term. It'll be here.
Yeah, it'll be here.
It'll be in the next slide.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, because that's the sum of.
Yeah, you just print out all the slides.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because remember, all of this is for your readership. You have the share folders for you to read.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Does this make any sense?
Yeah,
it's very clear, you know. I mean, all of this is for you guys. You can, yeah, okay. Yes. Okay, so now what is this chronical delta? This chronical delta, here what do you do? Here you have to have the same number of indices upstairs as below. Otherwise this symbol will not make any sense. So what do you do? Look, you take A1 with B1 and you write it here. Then you take A1 with B2, it will be the second term. And then finally, A1 with BK will be this first row. So the first row will be comprised, you take A1 and you combine with B1, you combine A1 with B2, and so forth, and then you combine A1 with BK, and then you have the first row. Then you go ahead with A2, and you repeat the procedure. You combine A2 with B1, you fill in the second row. And then you combine A2 with BK, you fill in the second row. And then finally you combine AK with all the guys below, and then you fill in the last row. Okay? So you have this matrix. And what do you do with this matrix? After you have this matrix, you take the determinant of this matrix. So you are going to have this chronicle delta is going to give you the sums and products of deltas. Okay? Let me just... No. You'll see. I'm going to give you an example.
A1 can be 5 and A2 can be 5.
Yeah, I'm going to give you an example. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, let me just give you an example. Let me. Yeah, let me just give you an example. Let me just give you an example. The way I wrote here is I take my A and I combine it with a C. I take my A and I combine it with a D. Then I take my A, my B, I'm sorry, combine it with a C, B, D, okay? Okay, so when I take the determinant of this, you know, then you have the product of your diagonals, like you say, right?
Yeah, I was thinking that A, B.
Yeah, minus, you know, A, D, okay? Of course, A, B, C, has to give you the over your dimensions of the space, okay. But another easier way to remember what this represents, you know, when you do the algebra and you do the determinant, you're going to have something which is equal to +1 or -1. And how do you remember which is what? So it's very, what you do is you look at the sequence of numbers A1, A2, and AK. You look at the sequence of numbers, A1, A2, AK. Remember, D is the dimension of your space. The dimension of your space is always greater or equal to K. But the dimension of your space is, in general, greater or at the most equal to K. Okay? So let's suppose that you have a sequence of indices upstairs. If the sequence of indices downstairs matches the sequence of indices upstairs, then this chronicle delta is not going to be equal to 0. Okay? Now, if the sequence of indices downstairs, forget about the permutations for now, if the sequence of indices does not match the sequences upstairs, the answer is going to be 0. Okay? Now, if the sequence of indices downstairs matches the sequence of indices upstairs, and it's an even permutation, they are related by an even permutation, the answer is 1. If the sequence of indices matches, but you have an odd permutation, the answer is negative 1. It's like when you go to a dance hall, you have 10 men, have to choose 10 women to dance. Anyway, I just give you something. You have numbers and you have to choose. Anyway, so the bottom line is, if the sequence of indices is an even odd permutation of the sequence, is plus minus 1. And if the sequence of indices does not match below with the one downstairs, you get 0. Okay?
Yes, so
yeah.
The set.
Yeah.
The unordered set of A1, AK,
yeah,
and B1, BK should, yeah, be the same set to be not 0.
Yes.
If there is any, yeah, of the A which is not in the B,
yeah,
or the reverse,
you will kill it. Why? Because when you take this determinant, you are going to kill it. Because an A will not match a B and you'll kill it, right? Yeah. Remember that delta AB was equal to 1 if A and B matches, if A and B match, if not, it's not equal to 1. And the negative sign has to do with the odd or even permutation, plus and minus sign has to do with the even odd permutation. You take a determinant. Okay? So this.
There'll be a 0 row.
Yeah, there'll be a 0 somewhere if they don't match. So this delta here, this object here, is the delta you plug in these formulas.
Ah, so the match of gamma is 0, in fact.
And there's a delta and there's a gamma, but yeah. So the algebra is not trivial, as you can see. The algebra is not.
Do we know the number of gamma,
yeah,
which doesn't have a 0 delta? So the number of terms in the sum?
Yeah.
Is it related to the factor?
Yes, the factorial, it's all combinatorics. I'm sure Raymond will be able to find a program to figure this out in a simpler way. It's all binary, it's all bits.
It's Clifford.
It's Clifford bits.
You know.
Yeah.
The program for Mathematica is doing.
I'm sure you have it.
It's very good to know how it is doing.
Yes. So Amrik is thinking. Yeah.
I'm just thinking.
Tony didn't do that, no.
So
no.
Where did the Tony part
end? The Tony part comes when I talk about the Clifford 8 and the E8 and Lisi's model.
So he's just using all this?
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so now let's finally go to E8, finally. Yes. You know, well, because I want to spend time on this because this is important for you, for all of you. Okay, let's look at the E8, okay? Okay, notice that the Clifford 8 algebra does not contain E8. Remember, E8 lives inside Clifford 16, suite 16, remember? So remember, you're looking at the tensor product, so in reality you need to have the tensor product of Clifford 8. Remember, this algebra is huge, because remember, you have 2 to the 16 generators, which is 256 square, which is 16 to the 4th power. It's a huge algebra.
Yeah, so there are 2 to the 16 generators in CN16, but E8 has 248.
Yeah, but I'm going to tell you how there's 248 generators live, how they are embedded into Clifford 16. Okay, so I'm telling you how the Clifford E8 algebra is embedded into the Clifford 16. Of course, I know that you're working with the 4D quasicrystal and the 3D quasicrystal, and you're playing with spinners and rotors, and to see how with the 20 group of tetrahedra you can visualize your E8, right? The Cartan matrices and all of that. But here, I'm going from the sky and I'm looking down, okay? So think of it, if you are in your 16-dimensional space, this Clifford algebra, due to the periodicity of Clifford algebra, the Clifford 16 can be written as the tensor product of CL8. Okay, so now when you have 16 dimensions, the number of bivectors you could have is 16 times 15 divided by 2 is 120. So you're going to have 120 by vector generators. And this is what I mean by this symbol, ij, is anti-symmetrization. This, I mean, you know, when you reverse one index with the other, you change the sign because it's a bivector. Okay? So you have 120 of them. Now you're going to have also 128 chiral spinorial generators. Okay, now I use the symbol alpha because it's a spinorial generators. And they are chiral because, okay, yeah, well, this is more subtle, but by chiral I mean vial spinners. Okay, let me erase here. Okay, so I have my Clifford algebra in 16 dimension has 2 to the 16 generators, right? Raymond, c'est vrai, no? Sedenions,
yes.
Yeah. So what happened, 2 to the 16, I can write 2 to the 16, I can write it as 2 to the 8 times 2 to the 8, right? I mean, it's just, okay? 2 to the 8 is what, 256. So you're going to have 256 by 256 matrix. So if you want to represent the Clifford algebra in 16 dimension, you are going to have 2 to the power of 16 matrices, and each matrix is comprised of 2 to the 8 times 2 to the 8 rows and columns. Okay? So you're going to have 256 columns and 256 rows. Okay? So your spinorial representation of SO16 will be a column vector. Think of it as a column vector, you know, with 256 entries. Okay? Now, by a chiral spinner, left-handed or right-handed, what you do is you split the space into two subspaces. Okay? So you're going to cut the number of components in half. So you're going to have 128 upstairs and 128 downstairs.
So this is SO16 divided by plus minus 1?
This will be the chiral representation. This is the vial spinner. I mean, the spinner will have 256 components, but 256 you can split it into a piece with 128 and another piece with 128. Okay? So think of it as a splitting a spinner. I'm going to split my spinorial space into one that has 128 components here and zeros everywhere, and another one that X sum as a 0, 0, 0, 0, and 128 entries here. Okay?
Carlos, yeah. Why are you still calling it spinner?
It is a spinner because it's a spinner representation of SO16.
But that will have bivectors,
quadrivectors. Oh, a spinner, you're right. The spinner is an object that has mixed grade. You're right. It has a mixed grade.
Correct. But yeah. I thought, and yeah. I was wrong, perhaps, because now you're telling me this.
Yeah.
When I was writing the paper, I thought the spinner is a grade 0 plus grade 2.
No, no, no. A spinner, in reality, a spinner has a mixed grade. A spinorial, when you write a spinner, it has a mixed grade.
Yeah, it has a mixed grade. So if you think about 3D, I'm thinking grade 0 plus grade 2. So
yeah.
It's a mixture of grade 0 and 2.
That's, yeah.
Right. But that I can visualize to be a rotor because grade 0 and grade 2 will give you a rotation.
Yeah.
Now you have all kinds of grades.
It's
grade 4, grade
it's complicated, eight. Yeah.
Now, why do you still call it a spinner?
It's a spinner because a spinner is related to your Clifford algebra. The spinner will give you the left and right ideal element of your Clifford 16 algebra.
But will it still be a pure rotor?
No, it'll be something more complicated.
So when you say spinner now, you don't mean a rotor?
No, no. I mean a spinner in the strict sense of the word. Yeah. Because what happens is when one learns things, one usually plays with lower dimensions and we think that those concepts generalize to all dimensions. No, you have to be very subtle, very careful with this. Yeah, yeah.
So Skinner is a rotor only in three dimensions.
Yes. Yes, Fang, you were saying? Okay. So now look how I level my generators. I have 120 by vectors, which I label like this, with I and J are like vectorial indices. And my alphas are spinorial indices. Okay? Alpha, remember, when you see alphas in the literature, they usually refer to a spinorial index. Do not confuse an spinorial index with a vector index. You have to be very careful. So now I have chiral spinorial because I'm reducing the, I'm looking at left chiral, right chiral, so I'm cutting the number of degrees of freedom in half. Remember, okay? So now I'm going to have 128 spinorial generators, chiral spinorial, and 120 bivectors.
Spinorial
is a generator labeled by a spinor index. Why is a generator that is has a spinorial index as a label? As a label. I label the indices of Y by a spinorial index. And this is what I call a chiral spinorial generator.
So three dimensional spinorial generator would be the bivectors.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes. Yes, and capital A and J are vector indices, and of course I combine them in this bivector form. Okay, capital A, capital J are vectorial indices, bivectors, and alpha, the Greek alpha, are spinorial indices. You know, and by spinors I mean spinorial representations of SO6. So you could mean left or right ideal elements of your Klee for 16 algebra. Okay. So now I'm going to have 120 bivectors. I have 128 spinorial generators, and the total sum is 248, which is the dimension of your E8 algebra. Okay? Now I'm going to tell you what the commutation relations of my algebra is in terms of these generators, in terms of my X generators and my Y generators.
And these are the only two generators in E8?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there are
16 has more generators.
Oh, it has huge number.
Yeah. So, is that exhaustive for E8, or does E8 have more?
No. E8 has only this.
Only the bivector generators and
the chiral spinorial generators. Yeah, no
so
more.
Are this all the spinor and bivector generators of CL16?
No, because you have another 128 that I threw away. Remember, because I threw away, I only kept 128 of them. Remember, I have 128 here and 128. I threw away half of them, right? Oh, yes.
You can build another
eight with those. Yes. That's correct. Okay, so let's look at the commutation relations. So I'm going to write the commutation relations of E8 in terms of the 120 SO16 bivector generators. And the 128 positive chirality left-handed spinorial generators. And I'm going to tell you later what the chiral operator is, okay? So let's look at the commutation relation. And there are only three of them. You see, the commutation relations of your E8 are only given by two lines. Two lines. That's all you need. Then, of course, when I decomposed the SO16 into SO8 pieces, it gets more complicated. But in terms of my 16 dimensions, the commutation relations of my E8 algebra are given by this.
But you would also have the anti-commutation relations.
Yeah, but in this case, because I'm dealing with an algebra, I'm only focused on the commutators. Of course, when you work with Klee for algebra generators, you have both, commutator and the commutators. But because I'm dealing with a Lie algebra E8, okay, Lie algebra involves commutators, yeah.
So the first formula, we can compute it from what we have seen before.
That's right, they are bivectors, remember? Yes. These are the bivectors, remember? I gave you the commutator of two bivector generators. Now, of course, remember, I use delta because here I have a Euclidean metric. Remember, E8 involves an Euclidean space. And Amrik now, I'm sure, is now knows that. And here, my metric is Euclidean.
Yes.
Okay, This, I don't write G because I'm dealing with a signature, Euclidean signature. Now, what happens when I combine a bivector with a spinner? You see, a bivector, what does it do to a spinner? A bivector, when you combine the commutator of a bivector with a spinner, what it does, it rotates the spinner. Okay, I'll let Amrik here. Yeah. Here. You believe that this commutator of bivectors is given by this expression. Now, when you take a bivector and you commute it with a spinorial, what it does, it rotates the spinner.
It's grade 2 and grade 1?
Yes. It rotates. Well, remember, no, the spinorial, be very careful. The spinner has a mixed grade. Be very careful. A spinner is an object that has a mixed grade. Be very careful. I'm sure you'll explain to them. Be very careful. You know, remember when I wrote a spinner as a matrix with one column not zero and the rest being all zero? And this means, when you translate it into the English language, this means that the object has a mixed grade. You know, so be very careful. A spinner, it has a mixed grade. Okay? This is why spinners are not that trivial to visualize. In three dimensions you can, but in higher dimensions you have to be very careful. Okay, so I take the commutator of my bivector with my spinorial charge. I get a spinner, and my structure constants are given by this notice that the matrix components of my gamma generators of my bivectors, the matrix components will give me the structure constants. Okay. Here, let's suppose I take the commutator of two spinners here, two spinorial charges. I get when I have two spinners, I'm going to get the bivector here. Notice here I have again the entries. Remember, alpha, beta are the entries of my gamma matrices. Remember? Here I have a bivector. I have gamma 1 times gamma j minus gamma j times gamma 1. And I look at the matrix entries of those matrices. And those are my structure constant. Okay, so look at these generators and see, you have a bivector with a bivector gives me a bivector. A bivector with a spinner gives me a spinner. And a spinner with a spinner gives me a bivector. You see how everything closes? You close the loop. And here I wrote down, these are bivectors, so if you reverse the sign, you have to be very careful. When you flip the index, you have to reverse the sign. Okay, now what do I mean by a chiral operator in 16 dimension? By a chiral operator, I mean the antisymmetric product of all of my 16 matrices. Remember earlier when I talked about the quadrivector, which was the antisymmetrized product of four gamma generators in four dimensions, and I call that gamma 5. Here, when I antisymmetrize 16 of them, I give it the name 17. It's just the name I give it, you know. So this chiral operator, this is what I mean. I'm going to tell you what a left-handed and right-handed spinner is, okay? Because this is something that Klee, you have to really explain to Klee. Because Klee thinks that the clockwise rotation and the left-wide and the clockwise rotation and counterclockwise rotations are related with chirality. So please, since you are here, try to convince him, explain to him that by chirality in spinorial language, one doesn't mean a right-handed, clockwise, counterclockwise rotation. Eh? Be very careful.
So helicity is a correct term?
Helicity is correct. So it's just people use the language, and sometimes the language confuses us. By left-handed and right-handed in Clifford algebras, you see, you have... Okay, since we're dealing with 16 dimensions, imagine, okay, you have your matrix, your gamma 1. Of course, you have to represent your matrix. You have to find a representation. In this case, it will be 256 times 256. But it's a matrix. Then you take the wedge product of all your matrices. Bah, 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 bah. Eventually, you exhaust 16 because this is all you have. You cannot go beyond 16. Okay. So this object here is really a matrix. It has rows and columns. Okay. So by a left-handed, right-handed spinner, which is a vial spinner, I mean an object. Okay, you're going to have a spinner here, a spinner. Which index? I guess you can give it the index beta. It's a column. It's made out of columns, you know, spinorial. So this object may have plus or minus one eigenvalues, okay? But if you find the right basis and you have a spinner, you're going to have two possibilities, the plus or negative value eigenvalues, okay? So I forgot what the convention was. You call this left-handed and you call this right-handed. I guess it's a question of convention, you know? I mean, choose the convention, just choose the convention you want. The bottom line is that you have a matrix made out of this anti-symmetrized product of all these matrices. So it's going to be a huge matrix because you're going to have 256 times 256 entries. You have a spinner, you have a column of 256 objects. And when you do the eigenvalues, you get plus, you get minus. And this is what you call chirality. So what happens if you are clever enough, you know, you choose a basis that simplifies life. So you want to have a chirality operator, if you are clever enough. You want a chirality operator that has a block of 128 here, unit 111, and another block here with a minus 1, if I do it correctly, of 128 and 128 matrix, and everything's zeros. Okay, so you choose a matrix, you're clever, you choose a so therefore you have a block matrix with one block has 128 times 128 entries with a plus one, and the negative one you choose the lower one. And of course, if you have a chiral spinner, if you are clever enough, let's suppose you choose a chiral spinner that has zero everywhere. You have 128 entries, which are all zero. And then you have entries 128, which are not zero. When you do this matrix multiplication in block form, right, then you are going to get, you are going to reproduce the same object, 128, because then you're going to have zeros here. So you're going to choose the plus sign. And you reproduce your spinner, which has the chiral, the positive elicited. If you do the same thing with zeros everywhere on the top, 128, and not zero, if you make a flip, right, then you'll choose the minus sign, and you'll have the negative chirality spinner. Okay, so you choose the plus. In this representation, with zeros on the ground floor and 128 entries on the top floor, and the negative chirality, you just flip them. Is this clear? Does it make sense?
So what would it be? It would be minus psi plus?
Okay, now let's suppose that you want to choose the negative chirality. Then you have zeros everywhere, and then you have an entry, 128 entries of not zeros. And then, of course, when you multiply them, remember, then you're going to have a minus sign due to this minus sign here.
So you get a minus psi plus.
Yes, minus.
Psi minus or psi plus?
Well, no, with the first one you get, okay, with the first one you have phi plus.
Yes.
With the second one you have psi minus. This is what you get.
That's the
eigenvector related to the eigenvalues. Yeah, related to the eigenvalues, plus one, negative one. Yeah. So you can condense this notation. People write a plus here, or a minus here. Just a convention people use, right?
So which sign?
You choose this sign or this combination?
Yeah, I get it. But which sign? So there are two signs, right? One in front of psi, and one is a subscript. Which one is the chirality?
No. The helicity has to do with something else. The helicity has to do with something called the Pauli-Lubansky vector that I'll talk about that later. The helicity has to do with the eigenvalues of the Pauli-Lubansky vector. Remember what it was? In four dimensions, the Pauli-Lubansky vector is this, mu, rho, sigma, and then you have the angular momentum, and then you have the momentum operators. It's like taking this combination of the angular momentum with the translation generator. You involve the angular momentum with the ordinary linear momentum. So you have to be very careful. The Pauli-Lubansky vector is something else. This has to do with the helicity.
And that is the handedness?
Yes. Well, it's related because when you have a massless spinner, spin 1/2, you could choose a frame of reference in such a way that the momentum of your fermion is parallel to the total angular momentum, or you can choose in the opposite sign. Let me see if I remember. When you have a massless particle, spin 1/2, okay, the number of helicity states is given by, what was the formula? 2 × 1/2 + 1. So you have 2, right? If I do it. So in reality, you're going to, let me do it in black. You're going to have, I mean, it's related to this, but you have to be very careful. I'm not going to conflate the two. You have a spinner, massless. Let's suppose that it moves to the right, or it can move to the left. Okay? So this is my momentum operator here, and my momentum operator here.
So it's plus for the top, minus for the bottom.
Yeah, you can say that. Now remember, when you take this object here, this object will have also when you're dealing with massless particles, be very careful. When you're dealing with massless particles, you're going to have something which is giving you plus or minus the momentum. So this is what you call the helicity. Imagine you have the spinner. How would you say it?
The sign of the momentum operator matches with the sign of the rotation, then it is.
You can say, okay, I can say spin 1/2.
Plus half, and the bottom one will be minus half.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, in that case. And that's right. And then you could have, this is the spin.
This is the spin, yes. So then you can say the top is a positive helicity and the bottom is a negative helicity.
That's right.
Now, how does this picture map?
Now, in that case, no, this is very different because remember, where this works only in four dimensions. When you're working in higher dimensions, then you will need more indices with the epsilon symbol. The epsilon symbol will have 16 indices. In four dimensions, it has only 4.
But let's go back to 3 dimensions, Carlos.
Yeah.
Okay,
and then in that case, what you are looking at in reality, you give this label 0,
yes.
0, and in your case, it's I, J, K, and then you deal with I, J, K. Okay, this is what.
That picture is still valid.
Yes.
That way we can define the helicity. How would we define the chirality in 3 dimensions comparing with that picture?
Yeah, well, the chirality, okay. The chirality in 3 dimensions, well, then you'll have to look at the gamma matrix representation, and then you have to look at the eigenvalues of your gamma matrix, you know, the analog of this gamma matrix, with your spinner. Your spinner, remember, okay, in 3 dimensions, the spinner will have 2 components, okay? So I guess the gamma matrices, you can think of them as the Pauli spin matrices. Okay, you have your Pauli spin matrices. You have spin matrix number 1, spin matrix number 2, spin matrix number 3. And when you take when you anti-symmetrize, you will get, you will have to do phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. gamma 1 times gamma 2 will give you a gamma 3. Gamma 3 with a gamma 3 will give you the unit matrix. In that case, will be the unit matrix, the chirality operator. And then you have to look at, in case the eigenvalues will be true, because the eigenvalues of the unit matrix will be 1, yeah. So then in that case, they merge. But in that case, you have a matrix which is 2 by 2, your chirality matrix. And then you have a spinner. You have spin 1, spin up. OK, this will be positive chirality. Mm-hmm. And then you have a spin down will be your negative chirality. OK, so spin up, spin down will be your right-handed, left-handed. And how does it compare with helicity? Well, okay, let me draw you a picture. Yeah. So I'm going to have four combinations. If I'm moving to the right, I can have a spin pointing in this direction, or I can have a spin pointing in this direction. In this case, you will have positive helicity,
negative. Yes.
And vice versa. If I move to my left, you could have a spin up or a spin down, then you will have here negative and plus.
Yes.
Okay, so you'll have those four combinations. Out of these four combinations, you will have positive helicity, negative helicity.
Right, and yeah. How does that map with the chirality picture?
The
spin up is always positive
chiral. Yes, and spin down, negative chiral.
Ah. Okay, so that's the difference.
Yes, yes, don't confuse helicity with chirality. So look at this picture. Maybe I should write in black. Okay, this is momentum. And this could spin up, down. Okay, spin down. Okay. And remember, this is crucial. You can look in the literature. This is very, very important. It's very, very important. The Pauli-Lubansky vector. The Pauli-Lubansky vector. And there's something very important. I have been talking only about massless particle, because when the particle is massive, they are more helicity states. Remember, you heard something about longitudinal and transverse?
Yeah.
So when you have massive particle, you have now the eigenvalues are different because you have a mass. When you have a mass, you have more degrees of freedom, and then you could have a case where the momentum does not necessarily align with the spin.
Yes.
Okay. When you have massless particle, the momentum may align with the spin, or misalign. You have positive helicity, negative helicity. When you're dealing with massive particles, there are degrees of freedom that allows the possibility of the momentum to be transverse to the spin. Eh? So write this down, because this is very important, because this differentiates between massless and massive particle. Okay, this is very important. Yeah.
So
it's funny that I have to go back to all these courses in quantum field theory. My God.
I agree with you that there is a let's have the discussion in three dimensions.
Yeah.
I agree with you that the chirality and the helicity are not the same, as you pointed out.
Yes.
If the spin and the momentum are aligned.
Yeah.
Parallel
or anti-parallel,
then it's positive helicity. Anti-parallel is negative helicity.
Yeah.
However, the chirality only depends on the spin, right? Spin up or spin down.
Yes.
It doesn't have anything to say with momentum.
You are right.
Correct.
So
he's talking about the handedness of the quasi-crystal.
Yes.
He's not talking about momentum. He's only talking about the plus-handedness or the minus-handedness.
Spin deals with an internal space, and angular momentum deals with an orbital space. you have to differentiate what you mean by orbital angular momentum and internal angular momentum. The angular momentum, you see, this angular momentum he's referring to, he deals with an orbital external angular momentum, not an intrinsic angular momentum of the particle. It has to be
but
very.
We don't have any particle here.
He means, remember, the chirality operator involves the gamma matrices, involves the Clifford algebra, and it deals with the eigenvalues of your chirality matrix operator. Do not confuse the chirality matrix operator with an angle, with a rotation. The very good word.
So what would be the correct word? Because it seems now from the discussion that neither helicity nor chirality
Yes, I have to think about that. But try to explain to him that there are subtleties. Well, in his picture, he's working really with phasons. He wants to look at the phasons in a quasicrystal, and they might have some collected excitations in your quasicrystals. Yeah, phasons is something more subtle. So, you're dealing with collected modes, it's really a many-body problem. So when you're dealing with a many-body problem, things are more subtle. Because phonons, magnons, plasmons, and phasons, and I don't know how many quasi-particles do we have now. Do you know the classification of quasi-particles? I guess there's a whole array, you know. But the bottom line, when you think of chirality, think of the gamma matrices. Think of the eigenvalues of your chirality operator, which is an antisymmetrized product of gamma matrices, and look at the eigenvalues of that matrix. Positive eigenvalue, negative eigenvalue. Positive one, negative one. This is what we mean chirality in terms of spinorial language. Helicity, when you deal with helicity, think about the Pauli-Lubansky vector. Think of this.
So the way I was, in my thesis, this was about helical waves, we thought about, I don't know much about chirality, but helicity was when vorticity aligned itself with velocity. So momentum aligned itself with the cross product of momentum plus helicity.
Yes.
So how does
So here is like, it's like you compute the momentum with this, by vector notation of angular momentum. Let's suppose I want to, remember, when I write this antisymmetric product, remember this epsilon symbol, when I take the cross product of ij, let's spell this out. Let's spell this out. After all, this let's write this like this. I'm going to write this in physics terms. In reality, what you're doing here is a epsilon vector with a p vector, and then are you taking the mixed product? This is like taking the mixed product, right? You take the cross product of two vectors, and you take the inner product of the other one. So this is like taking the
curve. Is a gradient operator.
No. Let's use letter r for position vector.
Okay, so you're taking a very particular kind of.
Yeah. So this is like orbital angular momentum. And then I take, remember when you take the mixed product of three vectors, remember? The mixed product of three vectors can be written, when you write it in the term, you write the components of your first vector here, the x1, x2, x3. Then you write the components of your second vector here. And then you write the components of your third vector here, remember? And this is what, and when you take the determinant, of this is what you call a mixed product. This is like taking the wedge product of x vector with y, and then I take the inner product, the scalar product with z. Remember in vector analysis, you take triple product. So this is like a triple product. Think of it as a triple product. Well, I mean, you can permute the columns, thickly permutation. So this is what this means. epsilon ij is like taking the cross product. And remember, because remember, when you combine an ij with an ij, you're going to have an object that will have a k. And then you can take, you can contract the indices, which is what the, which is what the scalar product does.
But isn't the angular momentum the curl of the momentum times some scalar?
The angular momentum? Ah, okay, but what happens is that, of course, you are using the rotational operation.
Yes.
Okay, the rotational operation, when you use the vector calculus, yeah, it looks, you are right, the curl operation of a vector. Yes, I mean, okay, yeah. Then you have to use what you... Yeah, then what you do is you write the components of your lambda operator, your derivative operator, like this, right? Yes, you're writing like this. And then you write the components of your vector, AX, AY, AZ. And then, of course, I forgot, here you should write the I direction, the J direction, and the K direction. And then you take the determinant. You're right. And then you will have the components, the I, J, K components. Yes, 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 yes. Yeah. But think of this Pauli-Lewinsky vector. Think of this, think of this in these terms, OK? But remember, this object lives in four dimensions. You must include the temporal component, okay? Because you're dealing with particle physics, you're dealing with Lorentz invariants, you have to use everything in terms of relativistic terms.
No,
it's a vector. Remember, there are vectors, yeah, yeah. Pardon. No, it's not, no, because. Like I said before, it's like, no, because you're taking the cross product.
That has to be curl of P.
Yeah, it has to be, yes, yes, the curl. Yeah, you're right. Because otherwise, because you're right, when you take the determinant of a matrix that has two identical columns, you'll get a zero.
Yes,
yes. Yes, yes,
R has to be curl.
Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, yeah, you're right. Something like this. Yeah.
Sometimes some scale.
Yeah, 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 yes, you're right. Of course, if two vectors are parallel, when you take the mixed product, gives you the volume that those three vectors make. If two vectors are aligned, the volume is zero. Yeah, I'm sorry, but I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
If you write this as a determinant, you will have two times P.
So this is fine.
No. No, but then you will have. Yeah, you're right. No, okay, let's do it. Let's write it like this.
So that, what you have just written, that is not equal to
this. No. This in reality is going to give you an object like this. K, P, K. Okay? This is because when you take epsilon ij, when you contract with, when you do the Einstein summation convention, this in reality is going to be a vector is dual to a bivector. So you could call this, which letter you want me to use? You could call this J Tweedle K. This is what you have. You're going to have something it's going to have a K index. It's going to be a vector. So call it J tilde, because this vector is the dual of a bivector, right? So in reality, you could call it J tilde, okay? So yeah, and then you take the dot, the scalar product. Yeah, 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 yeah. Now, when you deal with helicity, you are not dealing with an orbital angular momentum. You are dealing with a spin. Think of it now as a spin, right? So in reality, you should use the letter S for spin. And then tilde, the dual of your bivector.
But isn't that spin the curl of P?
No. Spin is not the curl of P. Remember, the spin really is an internal property. Because remember, when we studied quantum mechanics, remember we had orbital angular momentum and spin. A spin is something internal. It's an internal property.
They call it intrinsic.
Intrinsic momentum. You are right. One is extrinsic, that depends on how. Because if you are at rest, by definition, if you are at rest, you don't have any momentum. Your orbital momentum is zero if you are at rest. but you could have an intrinsic spin. You could be spinning around your chair in a very, you know, symbolically you can think of spinning around your chair.
So the Pauli Lubanski thing,
yeah,
is what you're saying is an intrinsic spin.
Actually, in yes.
However, I was saying that in hydrodynamics,
yes,
or any waves,
you deal with the vorticity.
Yeah, which is an extrinsic spin.
Yes, yes.
So there, that S is a curl of P.
Ah.
Now the question is.
Yes.
Which one of the two applies for what we call handedness? The intrinsic or
no, intrinsic. Intrinsic.
Why would you say that the handedness of the pig has to do with the intrinsic? There's nothing there, so what is intrinsic?
No, but well, this is what I was telling Klee, that one must not confuse the extrinsic with the intrinsic. Handedness. One has to be careful. In other words, the vorticity, yes, the omega vector is the curl of the velocity, right?
Yeah, which is extrinsic.
Extrinsic.
Angular momentum, which also defines the velocity.
Yes.
So I don't have to use the Pauli Lubanski thing.
You have to use the Pauli Lubanski because in particle physics.
In particle physics, yes. When I want to describe intrinsic angular momentum, yes.
Yes.
But for example, in hydrodynamics, we do not use the Pauli Lubanski.
Yes.
Because we use extrinsic angular
momentum. Yeah, okay.
But the question is, for the pig, which Klee calls plus or
the Fibonacci, I cosagree,
the QCS is what
yeah.
So in that case, are we using intrinsic or extrinsic?
No.
Because to me, it seems like it's extrinsic.
It's extrinsic in that case.
So then it is okay to use the curl of the momentum and call it elicit.
Yes, you could use that, yes. I think in Klee's case is more closely related to hydrodynamics.
Yes, that's what I thought.
Yes, yes, yes. That's true.
But in any case it's still helicity, not a chirality.
Yes, yes, yes.
But then what is momentum in this case? I mean, we have a static object, there is no momentum.
Yeah, but this is why the spin is lives in an internal space. You see, when you look at the quantum numbers of a particle, remember the Wigner classified particles according to representations of the Lorentz group back in the 1938 or something else. So particles have certain intrinsic quantum numbers, and they live like in an internal space. So one has to be very careful not to conflate the internal space with the external space-time. Although there's an interconnection. Yeah. Anyway.
Huh? Left, right,
yeah.
And the spin up, spin down,
and the spin up, you see, when you have a spin 3/2, how many states do you have? Let me see, Dugan. When you have a spin 3/2, how many states will you have? 2 times 3/2 gives you 3. When you add the 1, it's 4. You have 4 states. You see, the spin 1/2, the reason people talk spin up, spin down, is because when you take 2 times 1/2, you get 1. And when you add the 1, the degeneracy, you get 2. So because you have 2, then spin up, spin down. These are names that people give you. When you have spin 3/2, you're going to have 2 times 3/2 is 3 plus 1. You have 4 different states. So now you can no longer speak of spin up, spin down, because you have 4 of them. When you have a spin 7/2, you're going to have 8 possibilities. Yeah.
Spin up, spin down is
only for spin 1/2.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
But the fundamental particle,
well, in supergravity, you have spin 3/2. You have spin 3, the gravitino has spin 3/2. Yes, yes. Okay, so I hope this was useful. It's just exhausting. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Yeah, yes. Yeah.